Babylonian system, what, spiritually and psychologically. But what most people I found don't understand throughout various branches of IDMR, and you're living at a time when these principles are repeating right before your eyes. How are we going to get out of here? How are we going to survive the Babylonian system? Where will we go? What will we do? How will Yahweh take care of us? All of that is answered by the scriptures, the purpose and pattern, and most of all, this migratory trek. Now, as we said, just an overview, and we'll pull this out in the examples and analogies that I'll show today. But let's just think about it. So now down here in the land of Egypt, the world empire at that time was what? The Egyptian civilization.
Right.
The world empire. They weren't just little poo-buck people now.
Right.
They were a world empire. So Israel is in bondage, the Israelites, of that, which at that time they represented the sons of Yahweh.
Yes.
They were in bondage to a world empire.
Yes.
Okay? And they looked for a means of escape out of that world empire.
Mm-hmm.
Now down here, aren't we still under a world empire?
Yes.
Now, it's not a singular nation or a physical geography. As Lee has drawn out many times, this system is global. Mystery Babylon system now is an interlock of global financial commerce, trade, money, food combined. They control everything. Their power of control and mastery over all of the things that provide sustenance for us is just brutal. So, for example, they control our food. They control mm-hmm. the quality of our food. They're contaminating our food. They're poisoning our air. All for what? Filthy lucre's sake. They trade in all kinds of commodities that profit this mystery Babylonian system, but it does not profit us. So we are a different kind of. Many of us are in economic slavery. You know, the resources we have to support our families is just barely making it. And then the food crops that we have to eat for food, most people don't know anything about health, so they're eating the worst quality GMO-modified food, laden with toxic chemicals and poisons.
Yes.
Then you want to know, why are people getting all these degenerative diseases, yep. cancer, all manner of diseases?
Mm-hmm.
So that's another interlock of Babylonian system. They control everything.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we need to get out. So physically, just as Israel had to literally leave,
yes.
he brought them out of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
When they cried out and Pharaoh had pressed them so hard, took away the straw, said, look, Yahweh, we need some help. We got to get out of this joint.
Mm-hmm.
And so my point is that's what the sons are now. We are crying for our deliverance.
Yes.
But there's mysteries hidden in there. Just as Israel had a physical literal delivery, we will likewise have a physical literal delivery. But the most important point is just how Israel was told to take up the lamb. Put it what? On the inside of the doorpost, the four points of blood, it's the Lamb or Yahshua in us. It's
yes.
going to lead us literally out of this situation.
Yes.
What I mean by that, we'll get into the top, that there will be places we will be told to go by the Holy Spirit. A lot of people, they refer to them as cities of refuge.
Mm-hmm.
There might be churches of refuge. There will be communities of refuge.
Mm-hmm.
So you will literally be shown by the Holy Spirit, by angelic visitation, or unction, or however the Spirit leads you. And you better get up and go when the Spirit tells you to go. Because that principle is during the darkness and the plagues in Egypt, where was Israel?
Goshen.
So at some point in time, there's a separation or division. And in that, the first three plagues, both sides, Egypt suffered those plagues and Israel.
Right.
So that ought to clue you in. There's some turmoil, chaos, confusion, and plagues. This system, we're going to have to suffer.
Right.
We're already suffering some of them now.
Right.
But at a certain point, Yahweh's going to divide the light from the darkness. And then the devastating plague, as the Bible says in Revelation, don't have time to get it. It says, come out of her, my people. Those plagues are for what? Those plagues are for the wicked system, Mr. Babylon, just as the Stygian black darkness and slaying of firstborn was for what? See what I'm saying? So all these principles are repeated. So
yes.
like I said, where will we go? Well, you're going to be led. You're going to have to rely on being led by the Spirit.
That's right.
The same principles back here with Sodom and Gomorrah.
Yes.
Lot and his family was the only ones deemed righteous.
Right.
So Yahweh sent his emissaries down and he said, okay, before I mess this mother up, with hail and fire, I'm going to send my I call him my Don and I talk military terminology. He sent a recon team down there. Who was the recon team? The angels that went to Abraham It's like, okay, you know, we know that they had dinner with him and everything. That's
right.
The unity of the spirit. That was Yahweh Elohim Yahshua principle.
Yes. Right.
Okay, but the whole thing is that they, a recon team went down there, some angels said, let's go down in the city, let's check out how bad is the situation really.
Mm-hmm.
And they discerned it was really bad.
Right
because the, you know, those satanic, wicked people down there, they wanted to have literal sex with the angels.
That's right.
That's all they had on their mind is what? Lust of the flesh.
Right.
So Yahweh said, okay, I sent my emissaries down here. The report from my emissaries is it's not good. Sodom and Gomorrah, gotta go.
Yeah. Right.
So who got Lot out? Did Lot just on his own mind go, you know, maybe I should go?
No.
No. He had to be pulled by the hand.
Yes,
that's right.
Forced to go. Because some of us don't want to leave the system.
Right.
You know, if you have some connection, if you have something you're gaining from the system, sometimes even when you have this knowledge, you're like, oh man, you know, I just don't want to move nowhere. It's hard. People have inertia.
Right.
It's hard to move. It's hard to make change. It's hard to get rid of old paradigms. Just like it's hard to get rid of old karma concepts.
Yes.
But this time, I'm urging everybody. If you don't heed the call, everybody else left is going to be what? Like Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
You know, then you,
that's
the plague for Mr. Babylon, so you have to leave. So my point is we're looking for these signs to repeat. All of what I said in summary is kind of what we're going to talk about today as much as we can. So look for those signs. Look for a visitation. Look for the spirit within you telling you, you know what? I think you need to go down there, make sure you get your gas card fueled up. Make sure you got some water and a few supplies, because you know you have to go somewhere soon.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh prepared. Did he let Israel leave Egypt without some prep? He gave him some time to what?
Prepare
some provisions.
Yes.
Now you can't take everything in your damn house.
Right.
Excuse me. They didn't take everything, but they had what? For their journey?
What they needed.
What they needed for their journey out of Israel through this cloud and the sea.
Mm-hmm.
Now on the other side, of course, he fed them manna, et cetera, et cetera. So this is the mindset we have to look at. Those principles are repeated.
Yes.
And we don't have like another 20 years before these events are going to be occurring.
That's right.
They're really already occurring now.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of what led me to get into this topic. That's an overview of what led me to get into it. And as I began to see it, I said, you know what? You know, we got to get ready to move. The most important point is if you're not moving with the spirit within you, if you don't have the Holy Spirit and divine revelation of Yahshua in you,
right,
you can't make the move.
Right.
It's like somebody who gathers up all their gear, all their stuff, and they're too paralyzed in fear to do anything.
Mm-hmm.
The two are not going to work.
Right.
The mindset has to be there, the Holy Spirit in you.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of an overview of how I got into this thing. I've been doing a lot of thinking about that. My husband and I talk about it all the time. We said, you know, we need a lot of time. We're going to have to, everybody's going to have to heed the call of the Spirit within them. What to go, where to go, what to do, as we are facing times of unprecedented chaos. The chaos, the confusion, the corruption is already all off the chain. And then we haven't even added Yahweh's supernatural effects, which is the earthquakes, the volcanoes, movement of various places on the earth that I know where they are today, they will no longer be there. And many of us will also see that before we take off the flesh. So there's this whole kind of phenomenal events that were occurring here, down here as we approach the end of this age. So let me begin with my overview. This outline is kind of long, and I kept toying with, should I cut it up, but a little more, but I left it kind of 10 pages so I can cover some things, and then when you get home, you can read the rest. So this is my description of what I want to get into today. I gave you a slight overview already, but we'll read it. Someone can read that there.
There it is.
Upcoming events will cause great terror, turmoil, unprecedented chaos in our land. Global famines, crop failure, earthquakes, upheaval, and civil unrest. Many of these things have already begun. Also, look for various changes in the physical sun is a reflect of the true sun, Yahshua.
Now, all the strange weather we've been having this spring,
yes,
in the United States and around the world, those are all effects from the physical what? S-U-N. Sun changes in the sun. But the S-O-N is a type of what?
Yahshua.
So it's a signal that there are going to be changes for the true signs, or as a reflect of the true son of Yahshua, of Yahweh, which is Yahshua. That's why the sun is having some very unusual behavior, and it has various solar cycles that it goes through. But there's a video that's going to cover this in a little bit more detail, but I'll give you just a quick overview. Go ahead.
There will be extreme weather / powerful storms, blackouts, and exposure to corruption and evil.
Now, why would you expect blackout by the migratory train? Why would we look for blackouts? If we're getting ready to make a migration out of this system,
the
stage in black darkness. So it's very simple. This is where we are now in the purpose of Yahweh. You start looking for these things. There was, as a reflect, there was a power outage in New York about what a week or two ago?
Yes.
Now, why New York? Why New York City? That's a financial center of the Babylonian system.
Right?
Now, Yahweh blacked that out.
Mm-hmm.
So you see what I'm saying?
Yes.
That's a witness of what's coming for this mystery Babylonian commercial system. It's a small reflect. It's a little taste. That's what I'm saying. Go ahead.
You may have already noticed these things in current news, along with the frequency with which they have been occurring. We should be ever more watchful, looking for the signs that can help us to see where we are in the purpose of Yahweh, according to the divine pattern and the principles in the migration of the Israelites out of the chaos and bondage in Egypt. Our gospel is an up-to-date gospel, as the founder, Henry C. Kinley, did say. Prophetic dreams, visions, angelic visitations, and prophetic messages have also been more prolific, especially as we near the end of this present kingdom age. This was promised with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost AD 33, as was foretold in Joel 2:28-29, and was fulfilled in Acts 2nd chapter, verses 1 through 18.
So we'll read a few of these scriptures. I won't read all of them now. Let's read the first three scriptures that I have here.
Joel 33:14-16. Yahweh speaks in dreams and visions to open a man's ears and seal it with instruction. Isaiah 24:20. The earth shall reel to and fro like a drunkard, and shall be renewed like a cottage, and the transgression thereof shall be heavy upon it, and it shall fall and not rise again. And they shall go into the holes of the rocks and into the caves of the earth for the fear of Yahweh, for the glory of his majesty, when he ariseth to shake terribly the earth. Hebrews 12:26-27.
Mm-hmm.
Whose voice then shook the earth, but now hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven.
So down here at the end of this age, Yahweh is going to be shaking earth and heaven.
Mm-hmm.
The manifestation of that is these earthquakes that are coming so fast, occurring, you know, more of greater frequency, and they're becoming stronger and stronger.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And that is an analogy of, we talk about this all the time. As a woman is about to give birth to a child, the labor pain is likened to earthquakes or contractions. Don't they get stronger and stronger?
Yes.
Near the time of delivery?
Mm-hmm.
And the worst pains is when the little creature is about ready to come
out.
So that's another analogy to look at. So there has to be some shaking going on in this entire system, in this entire creation, because really Yahweh is getting ready to bring forth a new version of Mother Earth. We call it a new earth state. And the only ones that will abide in the new earth state is those that have received the new earth state here, spiritual and psychological. So we have a shaking here where we're making sure we conform to what? Yahweh's paradigm of moving into a different state in his creation. We call it new earth state. But that the most important thing is what? Spiritual and psychologically. But there will be a physical reflect or manifestation. Okay, do we read all that, Valerie? Okay, go ahead.
And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shapers, as of things that are made, that thou things which cannot be shaken may remain.
So what he's saying that here, that everything's going to be shaking. So only those that can endure this kind of mass shaking will remain. And that's why we have to have the Holy Spirit in us so that we can endure these things. Okay, so moving along. So we're going to start out with these principles. It'll be real simple to follow, because once you see, you say, oh, okay, that is repeated. So there we go. So, pattern of the land. We will have various repeats of famine in the land and also globally that are basically a reflect or a repeat of the principle of Joseph when he went down to the land of Egypt. Now remember, there were two things actually went on somewhat simultaneously. You had a financial collapse in Egypt where money failed, and you always had you also had a famine. So you had both a famine and a money failure. Now Yahweh gave Joseph the explanation of Pharaoh's dream. You know, the dream with the seven fat cows, seven lean cows. You can just read it there. Joseph explained to Pharaoh. So you can read it there.
Joseph explained to Pharaoh the symbology in his dream of the seven fat cows and the seven lean cows. Seven good ears of corn and seven thin ears. The cows and ears of corn represent 7 years of plenty, followed by seven lean years. Joseph was then placed by Pharaoh into the position to save the people by the wisdom Yahweh gave him to store up food during the 7 years of plenty, to carry them through the 7 years of plenty.
Okay, we know that's in the 41st chapter of Genesis, so we don't have to read that. Then you have, here's where the money failed in Egypt.
So when money failed in the land of Egypt, they were in the land of Canaan. All the Egyptians came unto Joseph and said, give us bread, for why should we die in thy presence? For money failed. The physical famine of food represents a spiritual famine of truth, the word of Yahweh.
Okay, so now, are there things going on in our current events, right in the news daily before us, that we can see some of these events playing out and repeating the purpose of Yahweh right in the daily events and current events of current news? Okay. Now, did you know that in Sardinia, in Italy, they had a terrible swarm of locusts? And the comment of the people there reporting it said they'd never seen anything like this swarm of locusts in how many years? 53. Now, so there's enough. There's an interesting number that's repeated. So after the death burial of Joshua, it was 50 days from Joshua's crucifixion, am I right? 50 days, death, burial, resurrection. No, let's do it this way. 53 days from his crucifixion on the cross to what? Now from the Holy Spirit. Okay, so when these numbers come up, Yahweh's giving sign. Okay, this is a signpost of where you are somewhere in the purpose of Yahweh. Now, what would that mean? What is that a principle of? Locusts destroying crops, okay? Or famine in the land. Is that a principle of famine? Okay, also, we can get that in the scripture. We'll get it in a minute. This fellow named Dave Ha, I'm sorry, what is his name? Zero Heads, the guy who has a Zero Head website. I think I'm reading something here. Oh, I'm sorry, I know what I wanted to read. Let's get Exodus 10, 12, or 15. He was missing the scripture. And in Exodus here, that's going to talk about the plague of locusts. Devastated every green thing. Now, it just so happens, as I say, globally we have manifestations of principles of famine. So, in principle, the green things or the crops, what? Are being destroyed. And most of it has to do with weather conditions around the world. The majority of it is too much rain, not enough rain, various other conditions in countries all over the world. And this is the article. summation of the whole situation. Okay, there are floods and drought devastating crops all over the planet. It is a global food crisis. He says, be coming. When is it coming? So let's read a little bit of this. This is written by Michael Snyder. It looks like global. Go ahead. Okay. Can you read that?
Yeah. I'm going to shift the chair over.
Okay, it looks like
global food production could be well below expectations in 2019, and that would spell big trouble in the months ahead. In recent weeks, I have written extensively about the problems that we have been experiencing here in the United States. As many as a million calves were lost to the flooding that hit the state of Nebraska in March. Mm-hmm. Farmers have planted less than half of the corn that is normally in the ground by this time of the year. And a lot of the crops that have been planted in the middle of the country are really struggling due to the extreme wet soil. Mm-hmm. But it isn't just in the United States that's facing a very, that's facing a very troubling year. Mm-hmm. Earlier today, one of my readers sent me an article entitled Global Food Crisis Ahead as Extreme Weather Events Devastate Crops and Fields Around the World, which I would encourage everyone to read. In that article, we are told that after the worst drought in 116 years, Australia has actually been forced to import wheat. Mm-hmm. And according to The Guardian, this is the first time in 12 years that this has happened.
Okay, we're going to skip around. That's here. Let's go to all over the world.
All over the world, crops are being devastated by floods, drought, and colder than expected temperatures, and many are desperately hoping for a return to normalcy for global weather patterns.
In the Philippines, they've had a scarcity in their rice crop. Everybody knows those Asian countries depend on what?
Rice
is a staple. So I'm just paraphrasing that. Did you know even in North Korea, they're having problems with scarcity of rain, which is affecting the food crop. Go ahead.
Things are particularly bad in North Korea. At this point, hardly any rain at all has fallen so far in 2019.
I think this article is as of March, if I'm not mistaken.
The rainfall is the lowest amount since 1982. Thus far in May, North Korea has seen 0.02 inches of rain. However, Pyongyang City and Nampo City, Kangwon Province, and North and South Hohhae Provinces have seen no rainfall. According to KCNA, if precipitation for the rest of May does not exceed 50% of the average annual precipitation, North Korea's January to May rainfall totals will be about 3 inches, the lowest amount ever recorded for that time period. Mm-hmm.
So same thing, so little rain, farmers have what here?
With so little rain, farmers have had exceedingly difficult time growing anything at all. And at this point, the nation is facing an enormous food deficit.
Now, I think I have a quick map that you can see. Here it is right here. This is the map. It should give you an idea of the devastation of all over the globe where there's all kinds of crop failures and crop loss. Look at this map, it shows devastating crop losses literally happening all over the world. Yeah, I have to pull up this map. So these little red areas, these are areas of various degrees of crop loss all over the world. Kind of blew that up. Okay, can y'all see that?
Yeah.
So you can see globally.
Yeah.
It's a lot. All over the world. So truly, there is a famine in the land already. And this is in, I'll say, still in somewhat times of normalcy, relative normalcy. So that obviously, these principles of famine, as in the land of Joseph, as in Egypt, with Joseph being the person who had saved them from the famine. So, hint, hint, Joseph is a type of who?
Yahshua
Messiah, who can save us from any kind of physical famine of food.
Right.
All right. Okay, so we want to be able to come back. Okay. So now, it just so happens that in addition to that, if that's not enough witnesses for us to see what's going on, but first I'll read this. I said earlier, some parts of our planet are dealing with horrific drought, but in the middle of the United States, it won't stop raining, but a very rainy spring here in America.
That's right.
In some areas of the world, it's too cold, while others experience record heat. But everywhere we look, we see extremes, and these extremes are not due to what the world calls global warming. It's all due to the behavior of our sun. Our physical sun is the primary reason this is happening. So the effects of the SUN are being reflected on Mother Earth, literally, just as the reflects of what? The SUN, the SON, is affecting the sons of Yahweh, all humankind and their planet, if you want to say more directly. Now I should have a, so this is a very interesting dream. So in addition to the witnesses of just the current events here that are unfolding before us every day, Yahweh is giving people all over the world, and it's not always just grown-ups, sometimes it's children, 12, 13, 14 years old, having visions of devastating crop failures, visions of everything green was dead. Take you right back to the plagues. All you get to do is go right back. So you can see the Bible is coming alive right before your eyes. But we're being brought up to date. How to use these principles we've been taught in the pattern, and as Dr. Kim has said, give you some kind of a map of where you are and the purpose of Yahweh. So let's look at this one here. This is a person who had a prophetic dream. Everything was dead. There was no live vegetation, not even grass. Saw in a vision or a dream. So our Elohim is able to communicate what? With his people.
Yes.
This site, by the way, is a footnote. This site called Why God, if you go to the basic whygodreallyexists.com, they have categorized links of all kinds of prophecies and dreams and visions that people have had, and they do it by subtopic. So you can at some point also do a search on whatever particular topic you're interested in and see if Yahweh has given someone a vision on that. Most of the time, this site, you will find several items. Okay, so it didn't bring up the one I wanted, though. I'm not sure why, so let's go back and try that again. Okay.
It didn't look like the America we know. Everything was dead.
There was no live vegetation, not even grass. That's real. I saw what was left of dead trees, the charred looking limbs lying on the ground and stumps of trees, as if they had been burned. And I knew that it had not been from some forest fire, but something else. I didn't know if it was from a nuclear war or what. There were only a few people on the highway and vehicles, and I sensed that these people were a threat. I sensed that some among them were losers who had no regard for their for these destitute people.
As you always got them damnful spirits in the flesh. In our class, we call them Pookie and Ray Ray.
As I drove through what looked like a large city, all the buildings looked abandoned and damaged. I saw only a couple of people. They seemed to be just wandering around in the daze. Everything looked gray and like it had a dusty haze over everything. I slowly drove through the city without stopping. It reminded me of a city that had been in war. I drove down the highway and came to a small town. As I came into this town, I saw another vehicle pull over and stop behind me. Three people jumped out of the car and crossed the street as if in a hurry, and I knew they were looters and a threat to the people in this town.
So y'all see, when the food chain breaks down, you talk about utter chaos in America.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Can you imagine the run on the grocery store? Can you imagine, just total chaos. So the point I want everybody to see, Yahweh showed me, we're getting ready to go into some stone, extreme conditions. Everything that you used to of normalcy, we don't have to just put that aside. We don't have to get rid of that concept. Because a new creature, the other principle by the pattern, a new creature, a new state of existence, a new birth, always has to come forth out of what?
Chaos
and confusion. I already said this. Israel did not tiptoe sipping some champagne and listen to jazz music out of it was devastated. It was utter what? But the sons were delivered out of that situation. This system, as you know, is getting ready to totally, fully break down. Because according to the scriptures, the Bible says Mystery Babylon has to be destroyed. Okay? It's just that we got to go along with the ride. You know what I'm saying? We have to go through the ride. Okay. Israel was not spared missing how they had, you know, the departure from Egypt in that within the midst of that chaos. Now, they weren't in chaos, but they were in the midst of it. Just like in your consciousness, you can be in the midst of all kinds of hell and not feel around you, but right here, what? Peace, be still. You are not chaotic in your heart and mind. I told several class members, I've had a dream a long, long time ago, and just summarize the dream briefly, is that the world was getting really crazy. And in the symbology, Yahweh used the city of Chicago. And me and some others, it wasn't just myself. People were just stone nuts. They were just walking around, going crazy. It was like all kinds of chaos in the city, all kinds of bad things. And then they came upon myself and other, not just myself, other sons of Yahweh. And they like stood for a moment and looked at us. How are you people so calm? In the midst, in the eye of this chaos around us, how are you, they, and you know what, they were drawn to us. We don't follow you. We don't know why you come. We don't know where you're going. We don't know what's in you, but we're going to follow you. So that's another whole thing. So we have to get prepared for those kind of things, too. Someone will see the light, the true light of Yahshua in you, in the midst of the system breakdown. And then I told them, we all might have some buddies we didn't ask for. You know what I mean? Kind of just following you, like, why are you following me? Well, just ask Yahshua, are they supposed to come with you? So there's the people who will be drawn to your light, your illumination, and your knowledge by the Holy Spirit to come out of this chaos. Anyway, go ahead, Penny.
Okay, about a block or two further down the street, I stopped and got out at what appeared to be a small store. This town was desolate like a larger city. It reminded me of a ghost town like. People had abandoned the area. When I walked into the yard of the small business, I looked down and noticed a large bag of fertilizer next to the building. I could see the backside of the bag. It was one of these bright green black bags that reminded me of Miracle-Gro, fertilizer. And it was the only thing in the dream that I saw in color. Everything in the dream was black and white, dirty, with a haze as if the sun was blocked out. I figured this must be a garden center or a nursery. But as I walked around to the left of the building, instead of a nursery with plants and trees for sale, all I saw beyond it was dirt and the same kind of large pieces of dead tree limbs lying around and sticking up out of the ground. As far as I could see, there was nothing but dead, dry, barren land. It it looked like some place that had suffered years of drought.
How about that? Go ahead, I'm sorry, Penny.
Or some type of devastation that caused this barrenness.
Okay, so you see.
And here's a picture, if you scroll up.
Scroll down.
Scroll up or down. There you go.
Oh, now this gives you an analogy of what Egypt must have looked like after the what?
Plague.
The devastating plagues. So this stuff, that looks like a damn nuclear bomb.
Yep, it did.
It almost looks like a, right, exactly, in principle it did. Okay, so let's move on here.
When I was walking back toward my car, I felt so sorry for the middle-aged couple running the store. I didn't need fertilizer, but I could tell they were in desperate need and they were trying to sell anything they had to have money for.
Oh, wow.
I looked down the bag that should have had about 25 pounds of fertilizer and saw it wasn't even 1/4 full. I rather realized that this was all they had left to sell. I saw the original price in the bag was $3.73 and wondered what she would ask for the little that was left.
Okay, we'll just read a little bit more. Okay, we'll end this paragraph after you finish this.
I know I didn't have much money with me, but insisted on asking. I opened my billfold and found a $5 bill, a couple of ones and some change. I handed her the $5 bill and told her to keep it and left the fertilizer.
Okay, so very, very chaos, very difficult, very bad times. But you see, principles of what? Being played, as was in the land of Egypt. Okay, so now. Let's go. Now, on the flip side, we know when Israel was brought out of the chaotic, plague-stricken land of Egypt, and as I was saying earlier, they had about 3 days' provision. Then they come out in the wilderness, and they're crying out for food, and what did Yahweh have to do? He had to feed them men and quail. Now, they didn't bring that man and quail with them. That was basically materialized from a cloud to feed the children of Israel. The Bible says Yahweh made the quail come up, or he could have spoken to those creatures and told them to come up where they could gather. And he also sent them the manna, which is really like a seed they had to make into like a grain. Okay. So the point is, you will be fed miraculously, not of your own resources, just as Israel at a certain point had to be fed what? Miraculously, not of your own seed sources. So now, this woman had another vision, this other woman here, she had a vision that God will feed us according to like the principle in the Lord's Prayer. He will give us our daily bread, but the reason will be our food will become really almost already is. So contaminated, so corrupted, so full of toxins and GMO and other chemicals that actually, even if the food is in the stores, it's really not edible. You really can't consume it.
That's right.
It'd be like eating toxic poison. You might as well put the skull and bones on it. So this is an interesting dream. We'll read this individual dream as well. Be part of it. I was just really astounded as how much Yahweh is giving people these dreams and visions, you know, to give them the information, as well as the other witnesses, to just see that this is how we're going to be delivered. After a while, it becomes like so obvious, you're like, wow, why didn't I get it before? So she was meditating on the Lord's Prayer, give us this day our daily bread. And the title is, Contaminated Foods Will Cause Us to Rely on God Solely for Our Provisions. And we'll read some of this pen. Okay. And she says, this is to Yahweh's or God. This message is for Yahweh's or God's what? Remnant. Everybody's not partaking of this. Go ahead.
The Lord has been silent for me for quite a while. I've gone to him in prayer for over 2 years asking for his continued direction and guidance. I've heard him repeat instructions from the past to me, but nothing much new. Most of what I've heard in the past couple of years are things that he's already shown and told me to warn this American remnant that is soon coming. A few weeks ago, out of the blue, I started repeating to myself out loud, give us this day our daily bread. It is still continuing to be utmost on my heart and mind. I've gone to God asking for deeper meaning and understanding than what I currently have to this partial scripture. I'm understanding that we are soon coming into this time when for each of us, each day we will need to go to our Father, asking each day that our physical needs for safe food be met.
That's deep.
Regardless if we have prepared or not, and to what level we have prepared, each of us will still need to go to our Father each day for safe food sustenance, or we will not make it. The U.S. food supply is contaminated. We are seeing more and more recalls in the food industry in every category of foods. Food that is tainted and unsafe to consume line our supermarkets, delis, convenience stores, shelves, as well as they are being served in restaurants and school lunch programs across our nation. Genetically modified foods aren't even legally being made to label their products, but they are genetically modified and a food safety risk. Meanwhile, many other countries ban genetically modified foods from even entering their country for being dangerous. As long as food are pleasing to the eye and tasteful and filled with delicious aromas, most Americans seem unconcerned with food safety.
That's how most people are. They just eat because it's so-called food. My husband and I call them Frankenfoods. They appear to be food-like substances. There's no nutritional value in them. They aren't really food. But we might read one more paragraph. You all see the point.
Added to this huge problem is that due to the chaotic extreme weather, our American farm crops, veggies, and fruits in the USA livestock industry have been devastated so far in 2019. Millions of cattle, hogs, lambs, and poultry have frozen and drowned.
Wow.
And 2019 isn't half over. Many U.S. farmers are unable to plant their fields with crops in 2019 because their fields still are underwater due to unprecedented flooding. Few Americans seem to take to heart the seriousness of all of this. When the fall of 2019 U.S. harvest comes, what will we do when food prices suddenly jump due to shortages?
So that's another thing.
Yeah.
That's another principle of famine. The cost of food skyrocketing as far as, you know, putting big dents in our checks to be able to purchase the food. So you have to look at the situation now. We're about to go into chaos. We're about to repeat the principles just like children of Israel in the land of Egypt before their departure. The plagues being poured out. They're being saved from the last seven plagues, drawn out, taken to a place of refuge or safety, being fed. You see what I'm saying? This is what we're going to have to rely on. Our little resources can and will run out. Okay.
And just to verify that, we usually get blueberries up here at White Cloud from this guy. And he has a blueberry farm in Twin Cities. And it cost $21 last year for 10 pounds. Guess what it is this year for 10 pounds? $26. $26. So, I mean, and even that is a better price than Chicago. I mean, in Chicago, you get a little bitty pint for $7 or $8.
That's right.
You get 10 pounds, you know, it was $21, now it's $26.
So I'm going to play about maybe 10 to 12 minutes of a researcher named Stan Dale. I don't know how many of you are familiar with him, but he's been researching astrological events, earth-changing events, earthquakes, volcanoes, etc., and basically various events here happening in the earth plane that people need to watch for, and a lot of this is because he has been studying the cycles of the sun. Here we go back again to what? And he noticed or understood that the cycles of the physical sun and its changes affect climate and weather conditions on the whole globe. Now, the true son of Yahweh, manifested in the flesh, Yahshua, didn't he affect climatic change? Now I'm not talking about weather. I'm not talking about rain and snow. I'm talking about the change of what? Transitioning Israel from what? Carnal mind to a spiritual mind by the preaching of the gospel, not from the Holy Spirit. And he fought some rough storms in the flesh in his interactions between what? The scribes and the Pharisees all sought to kill him.
Right.
So we are going into some very freaky weather patterns, very freaky climate conditions in the natural, because that's a reflect when we're getting ready to go through various changes in spirit and how we must operate and conduct ourselves down here as we go toward the end of this age. So he's going to tell you, just give you an overview, the physical sun in the heavens, it also has periodic pole reversals. The sun actually changes poles. You know what I mean? The top end and the north end switches and vice versa. So if the physical sun has polar shifts of changes, Mother Earth is what? The physical Earth is what I'm trying to say. Likewise also has pole shifts of changes. So there's a lot of research, I don't have time to get into it, that we're also going to have another pole shift on this physical Earth. The two poles will flip. North will become south, south will become north. Can't even begin to think of the chaotic changes in the configuration of Earth just from that alone. But anyway, we'll play about maybe don't know, 10 to 12 minutes of his video here, putting out much. He's also going to talk about this, a little bit more about the crop failures, and he's also going to talk about various blackout events are due to come due to, again, activity of the sun via its emitting these, what they call coronal mass ejections, CMEs, or solar flares. And he's going to go back and tell you a little history of, this has happened before, there was a Carrington event in 1800s, I got it down here somewhere, but he's going to talk about it. Then there was the one in Canada, and et cetera, and I think there was one in 1972 as far as one of these major solar flare storms that took the power out. So all of us know how delicate the power grid is now. We're so dependent on our cell phones, our computers. We won't even begin to mention high-tech technology and trading and all kinds of manifestations here in this world. They're going to have a blackout. And guess where the sun's available will be?
In the light.
In the light. Okay? So this such a country just for feet is really, is absolutely awesome. Yes, he calls it solar uncertainty. So we'll start this. Oh, that is definitely right. He's on the Hagman and Hagman show.
Sam Dale. What would have been true? I understand that, but StanDale.com, by the way, is, folks, if you don't know that by now, shame on you, StanDale.com. And of course, my EMP Shield Hagman for a special offer on that. What a great product Stan has developed and his partners have developed. The world's first whole home EMP protection device, my EMP Shield. Check it out, it's on the screen right now. It's listed by the Department of Homeland Security in their April 5th EMP Resilience Report, and it's a good investment, even on a bad day. And hopefully we won't have a bad day. So, anyway, Stan, you've done so much for somebody, and I want to thank you for doing that. What's on your plate today?
Well, you know, I'm probably going to be dedicating a lot of today's show to analyzing the sun and the history of its activities, what's happening now, what's going to be happening in 4 weeks or less around the 4th of July, and what Colorado University scientists are saying may happen sooner than we want it to. It's the sun. You know, it affects so many things in our ecosystem. I've got a slide down there, slide 40, where it talks about locusts destroying crops in Sardinia, worse than 60 years. Well, you know, we have it on our homepage for Hunting Reports News about the crop problems. Let me see if I can get over to her site here, that homepage. And you know, look down.
Why 60 years? 60 years is what? Second veil, representing the flesh. Things are coming to an end. You start looking at this kind of pattern and the migration. It's so obvious. It just like smacks you in the face. Okay, maybe since we discussed that a little bit, let's see what we'll look past that.
You know, excessive CO2 produced or carbon dioxide produced by human activity or cow gas or whatever, it is mainly produced by changes in the sun. I've been worrying about this and worrying about this. But if you look at today's show images page for your show there, that little slide 40 about locusts is only the thin tip of what is about to happen, what is going to happen because of climate change from the sun. More officialdom is joining the warning that I've been giving. Let's go to slide 43. And that should take us to the sun's wrath, worst solar storms in history. Now, this is an article from August of 2013 over in Science and Astronomy. But why I want to point you there is they've done its solar flares and storm.
Why would the physical sun be showing a principle of wrath?
I don't know about that.
Okay, because down here at the end of the age, Yahshua Messiah had to show a principle of wrath against the true sun. Get some scribes and Pharisees down here. He called them out. He called them what? Whitewashed sepulchers, full of demons. You know. And not only that, it's showing you that the true wrath of Yahweh is about to be poured out. What? On this whole land, this whole system. Go ahead.
Said it actually occurred since 1859. If you just scroll down just a bit, the first is 1859 carried in the bed.
So
that was mentioned to some of the people
for,
you know, years and years long about that thing.
Some of you may know about it, but he's just giving historical context of previous blackouts. One in the United States and one in Canada. But the principle is that at that time, they didn't have the technology like we have. They used what they call a telegraph system. And the energy that came forth from the solar flare at that time was so powerful, the little telegraph devices and burn them up, and sometimes even the paper, you know, that they were trying to submit the telegraph on. But he's going to tell you about all that.
And if we hadn't had electronics like that day, you know, wireless phones and all the stuff we depend on, we would have destroyed all that. Now, you tend to think, well, solar flare, is that frightening Earth? No. It sends electron storms down the front here. What happens if the electronic or crystal passes through it is damaged. But we're going to see here a little bit later in another article we'll talk about that with a normal, quote unquote, normal solar flare that hits the Earth and destroys some of the electronics across it. In 1972, they show on that one there that it blocked up the solar flare, blocked up long distance phone communication across some states, including Illinois. And this is according to a NASA account. In fact, when that happened in 72, AT&T redesigned its power system for transmitting cables. In 1989, major power failures were reported from the solar flare then by NASA. Quoting them, a powerful solar flare set off a major March 13th power blackout. This is in 1989. In Canada, that left 6 million people without electricity for 9 hours. I remember that,
whether you I do remember that only because at that time I was dealing with a Canadian client. And, I do remember that. So there was some trepidation, I think, initially about how long power or the electronic or electric power transmission would be out, if I recall correctly.
And you know,
we don't have time to get into this today, but most of us, that 1989 AD should be a flag, because that is 1,960 years since Pentecost.
That's right.
So that this 1989 in principle is 1960, since the dead Pharaoh is raised out by the Holy Spirit, which is 490 year cycles, which represents an end. So all these things, like I said, is significant for me.
It was a good test of our resilience, but it's also a good lesson for major power distribution networks and for, you know, all of us that use electronics and electric power. When Tim and I talked about making a grounding circuit to protect our new energy device and take electricity out of the atmosphere, that was what, like a couple of years ago, and we had no idea that it was going to be more important than the actual alternative that you were looking at. It's, as you know, it blossomed into a major business, but not fast enough in my opinion, because we're going to need these things all over the planet. And I think particularly here for us in the United States sooner than most people realize. We'll give that a second. Back to the article from NASA. In the year 2000, they had, these are major solar events that haven't wiped out the planet, but they've hit portions of the planet. And these are leading up to a major event, I'm pretty sure. And in 2000, the Bastille Day event, it's called, it was occurring July the 14th, 2000, and just came down. Now, it registered an X5 on the scale of solar flare. It caused some satellites to short circuit and then some radio blackout. It remains one of the most highly observed solar storm events and was the most powerful flare since 1989.
Unbelievable.
they can scoot on down out of that. That great picture they're showing of where it comes right as 2003. They called it the ultra powerful Halloween sunstorm.
So he's just giving some history of the sun has had these solar flares and coronal mass ejections and the devastating effect on the earth plane. But there's trying to go a little bit past on this particular section I'm looking for.
It had 9 major flares on the buckler over a 2-week period during that time. So you can see how busy the surface of the sun was then. The surface of the sun now is not that busy as far as numbers of sunspot activity, but certainly it is busy in the strength of it.
Office building next to us, I apologize.
Okay. No, that's all right. I just want to see if you're still there and then falling off your chair. Okay.
It's still early yet.
Well, that's true. Now, this research published here was saying, and I quote, "Now, new research shows with more confidence than ever before that super flares can occur on older, quieter stars like our own. Even though it's rarely so, about once every 2,000 years, it can produce super flares." And you say, well, okay, what's a super flare? A super flare, like we're talking about in stars about as old as ours, can be 100,000 times stronger than the current
one. Super flares, when and if they occur, can be what? 100? You said 100,000 times stronger. I'll play that back. I think that's what you said.
That's pretty serious.
That's very serious.
What this article is telling us is the... Whoa, did you follow it?
Sorry about that. No, we've actually got some construction in the next office building. Office building next to us, I apologize.
Okay. No, that's all right. I just want to see if you're still there and falling off your chair. Okay.
It's still early yet.
Well, that's true. Now, this research published here was saying, and I quote, "Now, new research shows with more confidence than ever before that super flares can occur on older, quieter stars like our own. Even though it's rarely so, about once every 2,000 years, it can produce super flares." And you say, well, okay, what's a super flare? A super flare, like we're talking about in stars about as old as ours, can be 100,000 times stronger than the carrier of that. 100,000 times stronger. Now, that's in some of the articles that we're looking at here today on this. And it's going to be a lot of high energy radiation when such a super flare occurs. But when I think back to the description in the book of Revelation about 1/3 of the earth's surface, the green trees and the grass and the fish in the sea being boiled to death instantly, just cooked from the increased energy from the sun, it then tells me, okay, it may be radiation, but it's infrared radiation as well as some of the ultraviolet stuff that kills living things, mm-hmm. and it kills them really quick.
Yes.
Now, I don't want to be on the side of the planet in space, and I prefer to be on the other side, mm-hmm. but no matter where you are on the planet, when this does happen, and well, it's going to heat up the entire atmosphere around the planet mm-hmm. and then the surface. It's going to affect satellite communications and probably knock out cell phones and, you know, GPS, all these kind of things are going to be affected. GPS, okay, you can use a printed map to get around. That's not going to be so bad, but our military and a lot of our other key infrastructure depends on the GPS being active all the time. In the battle theaters, which, you know, in the modern warfare, it happens in seconds, not in months of moving troops and things. It will be critical to know where you are, where your troops are, where the enemy is, where the missiles are, and to be able to interact with them. So if our satellite constellations get plundered, well, when they do, it's going to be just catastrophic for everybody involved, not just the United States, but the countries that we're at war with. Anyway, have a read of that article. It's a not-so-subtle way of them saying, you know, the government, okay, you know, we're looking at a situation here with the sun that's pretty intense, and it may happen, you know, a lot sooner than people think, so kind of keep an eye on it and prepare. this is so that we don't have a panic, and understand that. But this is what I've been telling you, and on Art Bell as well, when I first found out from the Air Force down in Australia, we have a problem with the sun. And in the last year, I've also talked to current Air Force officers involved with this kind of stuff, and they say it is the most important, the most pressing danger, not only the United States, but the entire planet. I cannot emphasize this enough. Now, thankfully, a lot of your listeners are getting themselves prepared. They've been ordered Holly's book, you know, prepared. They've been getting solar panels put in.
Because you all get the point. Later on in that clip, I won't play it this time, but he says even the velocity of our storms, like our thunderstorms, we think it was regular storm, they're going to increase at least 100 times.
Whoa.
So we're talking about the phenomena we're used to. I told you all what Yahweh showed me. We have some, I don't even know, say turbulent times is really just a gross understatement. So if you look at the chaos, devastation in the land of Egypt down here, and how Israel departed from that, and these plagues that were poured out, this, what you're going to see, we'll experience whatever manifestation we don't completely know, but the chain will be off, the scale, will be off the chain. So you see, we have to have some serious confidence in Yahshua in us to lead us out of these conditions. And or before. We may be already sheltered in place even before many of these various events take place. And remember now, I already gave you an example of Lot and his household. The angel said, Lot, you guys got to get out of here. You can't go back and get your favorite shoes. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
If the movement calls, I mean by the Spirit, we have to go. But Yahweh will give us a space to prepare, just like he gave Israel what? A space and time to prepare before they departed out of Israel. So all these principles are repeated. And current events, the signs in the heavens, the earth changes, they're all reflections or repeats or signs for us to see what's coming if we can just look at them through the lens of this purpose and plan of Yahweh. So I'm going to speed up just a little bit here. Now, we've really already covered this. We talked about the principle of blackouts, which we know is the same thing as Stygian black darkness in the land of Egypt for 3 days. But Israel wasn't light, so we don't have to go back over that again. I'm just saying, by the pattern you see, we'll have to have some manifestation of that principle of darkness. And we already talked about that out of the darkness, chaos, and confusion, there's always a new creature or a new state is born, just as Israel resurrected out of this chaotic, plague-stricken land of Egypt into a new state of condition, into what? Into the wilderness of Sinai here. And they actually formed a community. You know, they were ordered, had a law, according to what the Mosaic law given by Yahweh to them. But the principle here, this state of condition of Israel was chaos. This state of condition of Israel in the wilderness was a formation of a community of worshipers, what? Of Yahweh. And they were fed, they were miraculously fed, et cetera, et cetera. We already went through that. But as long as they were obedient to Yahweh, everything was what?
Good.
When they were disobedient, then now they got plagued, or Yahweh let their, when they got in Canaan land, he let their enemies what? Overrun. So anyway, we've been through all that. And we talked about, let's read these scriptures. We know that in the fulfillment of Yahshua and his ministry, at his crucifixion, near the end of the post-Diluvian age, as he was dying on the cross, what happened? It grew dark from what? The 6th to the 9th hour, from 12 noon to 3 p.m. And that was the end of that post-Diluvian age here. So we might as well go ahead and get this scripture here. Here, that would be Matthew 27:45-54. And also, there was an earthquake at the Messiah's resurrection. There was an earthquake. So we'll get both of those scriptures. Let's get Matthew 27:45-54. And then that should be the scripture with the darkness from the 6th to the 9th hour. Then we'll get an earthquake at the Messiah's resurrection. We'll get Matthew 28:1-6.
Now from the 6th hour there was darkness all over the land unto the 9th hour.
Mm-hmm.
And about the ninth hour, Yahshua cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my El, why hast thou forsaken me? Some of them that stood there, when they heard that, said, this man calleth Elijah. And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar and poured it on the reed and gave it to him to drink. The rest said, let be, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him.
Okay, that's all we need to read. We already read part of the darkness, right, for season right now.
Okay. Stygian, the principle of what? Stygian black darkness in the land of Egypt. Okay. Go ahead. There were also, there's also earthquakes in the site of resurrection.
Yeah,
I'm sorry. Yeah, you can get that.
Okay.
I also have Matthew 28:1-6 here. It must be another account of it. So go ahead. You can read it where you are.
27:51 in Matthew. And behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. And the earth did quake, and the rocks were split. And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints that slept were raised, and came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city, and appeared unto many.
Mm-hmm. Now, you don't have to read the other one now. It's the same principle there. Okay, so now, did you know that in the 6th century, that's about, what, 500 or so A.D.,
mm-hmm.
there was a time when the sun became dark in the day, and it lasted, guess how long? 18 months.
Wow.
That's just a witness in the natural. We don't have to believe Artie. 18 months. It was called the major global cataclysm of the 6th century, and it is basically not very much heard of or known. So maybe we'll just see. I don't think it's a long run. Okay, I know I got to. I have to paste that when you tried that before. So I have to paste that when it won't work. Okay. I mean, Yahweh has all kinds of signs and witnesses. I see what the scripture says. We have no excuse for not understanding his purpose. So many, such a great cloud of witnesses. This should bring up. Here it goes. I didn't bring up. Okay. I don't know why. We'll move on.
No, right? just go to Google, do Ancient Origins,
mm-hmm.
and then put in there.
The title.
Right.
Did it come up for me?
Okay.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. There you go.
It's called 6th century, the sun became dark. I'll just put that in. This should be here, right here. Why is the global climatic cataclysm of the 6th century virtually unheard of? Okay, so we'll read a little bit.
Shift your seat a little bit.
There you go.
And then move it up.
There was a sign for the sun?
Yes.
Can you see it right now?
I'll go ahead.
There was a sign for the sun, the like of which had never been seen and recorded before. The sun became dark, and its darkness lasted for 18 months.
18
wow.
months.
Each day it shone for about 4 hours. And still, this light was only a feeble shadow.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone declared that the sun would never recover its full light again.
Now, I bet you those people were scared to death.
Yeah,
you know, they were terrified.
I'm scared shitless, boy.
Between the years 535 and 536, a series of major global climatic events that took place that could easily be described as global climatism and with catastrophic consequences. The above abstract is from a 6th century historian and church leader, John of Ephesus. and his historical work, church's history.
Okay, that's all we needed that. So you see that there was that event, okay. So, how very interesting. We had a sign recently of a blackout. There was a recent blackout, just a few weeks ago. Maybe a little over a week. Was a recent sign of this in the news. We had a blackout in New York, which is a powerful world financial center. A Manhattan transformer, they had a fire and it knocked out power to thousands of people in New York. As I said earlier, the significance of New York City, that is the major global center in this world, of the global financial system, had a powerful blackout. So their day is coming.
Yep.
It came up as a video.
Okay, I'll play it. I was actually gonna jump to something else, but that's okay. I think it's short.
It's only 4 minutes.
Okay.
4 minutes.
Sure, it's the right. Yeah.
You haven't seen the sun in like forever, so you search for a beach vacation. Sunny beaches, sandy beaches, big beaches.
Say that.
So that's sort of the sentiment. Everyone anxiously awaiting. Gentleman we just talked to has got work tomorrow, and he needs to get back inside. A lot of people want to get back inside. Looks like the press conference is about to begin. Jessica, I don't know if we want to toss it back to you in the studio because we have another camera covering this news conference.
All right, here we go. Here's the press conference starting right now. Let's take it to you live.
I'd like to introduce with me here today as well public advocate Jemani Williams, Comptroller Scott Stringer, Borough President Gail Brewer, as well as Assemblymember Linda Rosenthal. A quick update, at 6:47 p.m., there was an electrical disturbance in the system affecting approximately 62,000 customers in the Manhattan area. This was caused by Police Department and Emergency Management responded quickly to the scene, and we are working closely with Con Ed to restore power as quickly as possible. We have no reports of injuries or fatalities at this time. We also have a list of those individuals that are on life-saving equipment, and we are working with them to make sure they have what they need. And we have put together a joint task force with PD and the Fire Department to make sure that nobody is stuck in an elevator still. Right now, I'd like to turn it over to the CEO of Con Ed, John McAvoy, to give an update from Con Ed.
Hi, good evening. Thank you very much. My name's John McAvoy. I'm here to represent Con Edison. We experienced a significant disturbance on the west side of Manhattan at one of our electric transmission stations at roughly 6:47 p.m. that eventually interrupted power to approximately 73,000 customers. We divide the electric system into what we call networks, which are roughly equivalent to neighborhoods. It interrupted power to 6 networks. We expedited the recovery, performed an initial assessment of what was the most likely cause, isolated that equipment, inspected the other equipment to identify any obvious abnormalities, and now we have started the restoration process. Of the 6 networks that we lost, we restored 2 of those networks starting from just before 10 p.m. And we are working to restore the remaining 4 networks by midnight tonight. Now, there are some unknowns in this. As we restore equipment, we may find damage that we're not currently aware of. But we are proceeding on a path to restore all customers by midnight tonight.
I haven't followed up. I don't know if that has if it's been fully restored.
Probably for the most part.
For the most part, it has.
Yeah, what happens is that they have, like those nodes is what he's talking about.
Mm-hmm.
They have crews going into substations and actually repair it. Depending on how extensive the wire damage and the panels are, the panels can be blown. Well, they are probably will blow them out, but it depends on what happens.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how extensive the damage is. But I'll tell you one thing, as well thing too, is that Now, I had that happen on Wall Street. You know, they got tons of what? Of residual backup power. They got probably got redundant, probably got triple redundant backup power for that because they want to make sure that at least Wall Street does what?
They can stay open.
You know something, Chicago had a power outage on July the 10th at 3 a.m. in the morning. There was about an hour from the south side. The power went out.
When you woke up in the morning, was it back on?
No. It went off at 3 mm-hmm. and it didn't come back on. We were already open.
I would say also that Homeland Security is probably very aware of our power infrastructure in this country and that a few dedicated people could cause havoc and chaos in this country by hitting the massive transformers that are in some of the major metropolitan areas. Oh, and yeah. These massive transformers, they don't have like a gigantic backup supply of them. You've seen some of them, they take weeks to move across the country. They're very large, mm-hmm. and they're not, you know, it's not like they can say, all right, power's out, go down to, you know, 5th and whatever and grab one. No, it's considerable, and it takes time to make them, and there aren't many in supply, so yeah. And that's just something to think about.
Right. And the other thing, too, is that, you know, our power systems, all these power systems are actually interlocked. Mm-hmm. You know, West Coast, East Coast, you know, North, South, and what happens is a lot of them are actually feeding, you know, others. And the infrastructure, even in the interlock, is actually pretty, you know, pretty weak, meaning that they haven't upgraded it, software-wise, as well as even, you know, just even, you know, cabling and things. So, it's not gonna look pretty, because you blow that out, you're not blowing out just the neighborhood. You're blowing out what? The whole region, and the whole city, and the whole area. Because again, those things they actually feed. You have different. You know, different segments or regions that it actually feeds.
And you know, something I did want to chime in about when you were talking about extreme weather, I don't know if everyone heard about Paris and these 105 degree temperatures.
Yeah,
Paris.
Yeah, all of Europe is in
the
middle.
Yeah, all of Europe has these extreme temperatures.
All over the world.
Yes.
So what I was looking at is, you know, you guys were already talking about, there's all kinds of technological things or failures that could occur that could cause us to have a blackout. You're talking with the power grid itself. Then if you add things like EMP, solar flares from the sun, all these different events that could cause a blackout, the point is we will have a blackout.
And software and virus, true. You know, just embedding a virus into the
cyber attacks, right?
By software systems.
But the point is, when Yahweh gets ready to have his true blackout, there is no technology that can compete with that. Yahweh's technology, or Yahweh in causing a blackout, divinely so, it'll pale in comparison by any of man's technologies or ability to produce a blackout. So, because he is a principle, let's read this in Isaiah. Yahweh is able to cause a blackout or darkness without use of man's weapons or technology, because he is both what? The light and the darkness. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, Yahweh, do all these things. Now, I want to play a brief video. People are having visions, like I said, just popping off like crazy all over the world. A brief part of this video, this is an Australian woman named Bella Petrina, and she had a vision or a dream where she saw 3 days of darkness coming to the earth. And she said it was like the plague in Egypt. It was like of darkness. It was like darkness that could be felt. So we'll play just a little of this. I'm just showing you, Yahweh has so many witnesses, I mean, including showing people dreams and visions in fulfillment of Acts and in Joel.
Yes.
This, right, prophesied in Joel fulfilled in Acts.
Emergency.
Can everybody hear
it? Message for your soul and your spirituality.
your volume more.
3 days of darkness is coming to the unit. I have got to tell you, God's been on me to reveal this to you.
That's 100 right now.
Yeah, it's like a one.
You have to listen to what calls in for the
court. And if you know if you're warned, you can prepare, can't you? Mm-hmm. So there's 3 days of darkness, because what's happening is there's 3 heavens saying. And the darkness from the second heaven is Lucifer, his demonic angels, and the fallen angels are being pushed to earth. And you know when it's always darkest just before dawn? Mm-hmm. It's going to get really, really, really dark. Because they're being pushed down, and then unconditional love, the light, the brightest light you've ever seen comes to planet Earth and will take out the darkness. So what happens is the light gathers upon itself, and we are caught up, or hapazo, a hapazo.
I'm not sure what that means.
So the 3 signs that this 3 days of darkness is coming, and you need to prepare for it, or be aware of it. And to me, it's not going to take long. It's not 10 years. It's not 5 years. It's not 3 years. It's less than that. Okay? So it could be any day now. But to me, it's definitely less than that. I can get down even nearly half that, and we'll be there. So things are speeding up. The shutdown in America is the beginning of sorrows. If you're interested in learning about that, go to Holy, Holy, Holy. And I'm uploading scriptures from all this download that I've received. So then God put it on my heart to share it with you. So what happens is there are going to be 3 days of darkness. The darkness from second heaven is being pushed to earth. Now this is not a normal darkness. This is not like, oh, that'd be fine. This is a darkness you can feel. Very, very oppressive. And it has been to the earth before. What happens is it actually comes out from the Hades. It's going to come out from hell. And soon when they opened up, I don't know if you
can. Well, some of that stuff is her speculation.
Around
you also the principal.
The 23rd of September last year. The year before now, 2017. Right? So there have been warnings. There are warnings in the sky and the moon and the sun. To keep to the scripture, we just said, trying my hardest. I'm an infant in Christ. I've been sharing messages, healing, and guidance for many years. And since receiving the Holy Spirit, I know it's like I get the very big picture. So there is going to be a missile strike. That's the one, the first sign. It's the beginning of the end. So once the missile strike is from Iran to Israel, right, that creates a cosmic event. That creates cosmic signs or the aurora appearing, you know, colored lights. And they're dancing colored lights in the sky. These are global auroras. These global auroras can cause reddish skies worldwide. And, you know, they're talking about an appearing a near-Earth planetary object. So some of you are awake to this, some of you are
around a little bit.
Like, if you have a friend and they don't have their phone, they're like, never me. But you know, you can't find your phone for 3 days. Imagine that. So the whole grid goes down. Right? No communication. There's no telecommunications. There's going to be no.
That don't mean y'all can't communicate.
That's right.
We just talk the telecommunication on this world.
That's bad.
Power. There's no grid. Could be off the grid. It's really, really soon. Really, really soon. So the darkness is because the light is coming, right? It's darkest before dawn. So in those 3 days, there are instructions to not open the doors or windows to anything, like anything, even if a demon sounds like your son, your daughter, your grandmother, it doesn't matter. You're not allowed to open the door. Do I understand?
Won't that be a reflect down here to what it is we have to do with the land? They were in the light.
Right.
Now, they weren't supposed to let nobody else. You follow what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
They weren't told by y'all to let somebody else come over there to their light.
Mm-hmm.
That's the part I wanted to play to. Because some of us, you see, what Don and I discussed, we kind of got some things wrong. We think that our flesh and blood relatives are necessarily going to tag along with you wherever you go.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh is not us. The Spirit is dividing what? The sheep from the goats.
That's right.
So if you're told to go to Goshen,
That don't mean you're supposed to bring everybody in,
right,
or anybody, everyone. You follow what I'm saying? So Yahweh is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a difficult thing to think about. But the most important thing is follow the voice of what Yahweh tells you to do. That don't mean you're supposed to broadcast to every cousin, first cousin, third cousin, twice removed. Y'all know what I'm trying to say.
Mm-hmm.
This is not, never has been about the flesh and the blood.
Right.
Don't worry about that. You go where Yahweh sends you to go.
Mm-hmm.
Whomever is supposed to be here that you love because they are a blood relation or whatever, friendship, Yahweh knows how to get them there,
right,
if they're supposed to be there.
Right.
We're not, it's not for us. So I just want, when she said that, I said, now, wait a minute now. We don't, this is not an open invitation like a party.
Right. Right.
Everybody come on down.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know if they're of the light or of what?
A dark.
Of the darkness.
Right.
So, anyway, I'll move a little faster now because some other points I really want to spend a little time kind of setting the foundation here, but I'll move a little faster. Okay. So now, interesting thing, to change subject a little, change top, it's within the topic, but to change the subject matter we're going to look at. So, the other thing that's going to repeat is that Yahweh will give world leaders dreams to help them make the right decisions. Now, where did that come from? That's going to repeat. We don't have the chart, but Daniel in the land of Babylon, we know what happened to him. Nebuchadnezzar actually had a dream. He had
right.
a dream of many world empires, including his own. And the dream perplexed him. I'm not reading the scripture for sake of time. And it took a man with an excellent spirit, the Bible says, Daniel, land of Egypt. He was shown Nebuchadnezzar's dream and the interpretation thereof.
Mm-hmm.
So following all of that, actually that saved Israel in their captivity in the midst of Babylon. Because, you know, the devil said, you know, I can use these people. They got some gifts. In modern day vernacular, we say they have some skills.
Mm-hmm.
And Daniel was raised up in the land of Babylon. In the sense, what I mean is not raised in physics. I mean, he was raised up in the Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom like an advisor and a counselor.
Right.
Because he could what? Interpret his dreams. And similar principle with
Joseph.
Yeah, just like, that's going to repeat. So we're going to have principles. Some person or persons playing a role like Joseph. Some person or persons playing a role like Daniel. Right down here, in the midst of these kingdoms, and these kings of this present age that we're in. So just so, I'll play just a little short, I played this video before, but it's so interesting. This young fellow, white Christian fellow, he had a dream that an angelic encounter, an angel visited him in this dream, I'll play some of this, and the angel told him he was a guardian to the United States president. And the angel told him or showed him that the spirit of Daniel will repeat. So I'm saying a manifestation of providing some kind of advice or counsel by the spirit of Yahweh in them to heads of state, presidents, leaders, we don't know. We have to see how it plays out. Now, just as a type of analogy, I don't have time to read it, but I don't know how many of you know, the first president of the United States, George Washington, he had an angelic visitation during the very rough time during the Revolutionary War. In the early history of the United States. You can go to the website and read that. But this angel actually appeared to him as a woman, and he was totally astounded and perplexed because he was in his tent alone. And this angel appeared, and the angel basically showed him the whole future of the Republic of the United States. So anyway, I don't have time to get into that now. You can go back and read that. And this one I should already have up here. We're going to play some of this, maybe less than 10 minutes. You'll get the point here. Young man's name is Stephen Powell, a young Christian.
see if this works, you guys. Forgive me as we get settled in here. You're going to want to hang out, you guys, and definitely hear this. I had a very, very powerful angelic encounter last night. I don't think I've ever had an angelic encounter like this before. Okay? I've had a lot of powerful angelic encounters and encounters from the Lord Jesus, but I've never had this type of one in which I was visited last night, you guys, by a guardian to U.S. presidents, one of the angels that's on protective duty for U.S. presidents and has been since the beginning.
How about that?
All right, now I got my microphone in Periscope. Let me guys know. Can you guys hear me, Periscope? Can you hear me good? Let me know, guys. Hey, what's up, Regent Life Church in Homer? Bless you. It's loud? Is it really loud? Loud and clear. Awesome. Cool. I have to remember to wear this more often. But yeah, let me give you guys one more chance. If you're watching on Periscope, if you're watching on Facebook, if you could go ahead and share for me. Share on your Facebook feed. Share on Periscope. Share on Facebook and Twitter if you're on Periscope. And I'm going to let this loose, you guys. And I'll begin to tell you what happened. I'll just get it out there. If you guys watched my Periscopes or my Facebook Live last week, I had a powerful vision last week that I released, and I just wrote it in article form. But this was very, very powerful. When this angel came last night to visit me, I had about 10 different visions. Okay, I won't be able to get into all of them, but several of these visions that I had last night pertain to America's future. So you're going to want to hear this. You're going to want to hang around. Just be patient with me as I try to get it out there. Hey, Pastor Tommy, bless you. It was at 1 o'clock in the morning. Let me just tell you what happened, okay? Here's what happened. I was actually asleep. I fell asleep in my bed about 11 p.m. last night, and I had been asleep several hours. And this angel actually came and visited me when I was sleeping. He actually came into my dream, my flow of consciousness that was happening while I was dreaming. Okay, and here's what I saw. Okay, let me just get to my notes on this. Okay, I was in this vision while I was sleeping. And I was walking up behind a man, and this man was surrounded by people, okay, and surrounded by, guards and what looked like, security, Secret Service, that's what they're called, right? And the man stopped, okay, I was walking behind him, he stopped, and he turned around, and it was George W. Bush, actually, okay? And George W. Bush went to shake this other man's hand that was behind him. And he just wanted to thank him for the service. But I looked at this man, and this man's name was Billy, but it wasn't a man. It was an angel. But he was dressed just like a Secret Service agent. He had on a black suit and a tie, and his name was Billy. Okay? Now, oftentimes, angels' names or anybody's names in spiritual matters are significant. And check this out, you guys. I went and looked up the name Billy. Billy is a nickname, as many of you know, for William. And William actually means resolute protector.
So when Yahweh gives people these visions and dreams, they'll receive these angelic forms.
Oh, I do that.
Remember, an angel is an incorporeal spiritual embodiment. So when it comes down or appears in your dream, how they're dressed, their appearance, their manner is all symbolic of whatever principle they're trying to convey. Which is why some people, we know angels have no sex. Literally, like we do, no sex roles. If they a female angel may appear, because part of its mission is it's representing the principle of the female side, or it may appear very warlike or very masculine, because it's part of its message is representing what the masculine side. And this angel was dressed like a Secret Service agent, not literal clothes. Mm-hmm. That's how it's appearing in the show. For I'm a protector. Mm-hmm. See what I'm saying? Just like the Secret Service protect what United States presidents. Mm-hmm. Go ahead. So the symbology is there,
Resolute protector.
Mm-hmm.
So I actually believe, you guys, that I had an encounter last night with an angel that actually protects presidents. Just like presidents, U.S. presidents and the office of the presidency has a whole platoon, so to speak, a whole company of angels that are assigned by heaven to protect the president. And, you know, they walk around with the president, okay? And what happened was this right. This encounter with this angel was so powerful in the glory, it actually woke me up. It woke me up out of my sleep, okay? And when I woke up out of sleep, I was conscientious. I could feel the angel standing right next to me. I could feel the glory. The glory was so intense. And, you know, one of the titles for angels in the Bible, you guys, is they are the cherub that cover, right? They're the cherub that cover. So what I found is a lot of times when these angels come and stand next to me, there's such an overarching, like, powerful canopy of glory. And while I'm under that canopy of glory, hey, what's up, Carl? I go into visions. I go into visions very, very easily. So I went into about 10 visions when I came out of my sleep laying on the bed. Here's the first one I saw. I saw, okay, a moving truck backing up to my house, a new house.
Tim, we'll skip over this part because I just want to get to the part. For sake of time, I want to kind of wrap up in the next 25 minutes, give Willis some time. He saw symbolically a very wealthy family, the Bush family. And in essence, it's not literally the Bush family. Remember, these dreams are symbols and signs of what it represents. But in his dream, the reason he saw the Bush family, because they're a very wealthy, well-connected family. But he saw them donate or give money and things to support the ministry. Follow what I'm saying? So don't take it as literally the Bushes. George Bush is going to give up money to support the ministry, but it's saying Yahweh is going to use people of wealth and means to help support the ministry, our ministry, the ministry of the truth. All kinds of crazy stuff is going to happen. People
just like in Egypt.
Just like in Egypt. So anyway, that's what he's saying. You know, he saw furniture moving in his house that was given by wealthy people. That's all analogy, okay? But I'm trying to get to the point, I don't quite remember it is, where he basically says that there will be individuals who become counselors and advisors to presidents, and it's just like Joseph was to Pharaoh in the land of Egypt, and Daniel and the boys were in Babylon. If I can't find it, we all get the principle. Let's get to the clip. Here.
Economic turmoil and economic hardship in this country. I believe that's the significance of the year compared to today with 1885. Okay? Let me read you some more here. The rapid expansion of industrialization led
a lot of these people also
the jobs that
class.
In large part the jobs have left. Okay, the
we agree.
You know, the British Washington D.C. District of Columbia, right? But spiritually speaking, I believe personally, just based on this encounter and other things the Lord spoke to me, I believe that spiritually speaking, Kansas City is like a capital of the spirit.
Okay,
okay, for the church. I mean, that's why you've had, literally, I mean, like, if the next U.S. president, okay, I'm believing for it to be Donald Trump. I believe that it is Donald Trump. That's who the Lord's chosen. Okay, I'm trying to separate my personal beliefs, and I'm trying to tell you guys, okay, the pure revelation. But beside that, okay, what if the next U.S. president had a counselor that was like a true prophet?
There we go.
I praise God for all the other ministry gifts, but I believe that world leaders need prophets. Mm-hmm. They need people that have a not just an accurate history of hearing God, mm-hmm. but hear the things that prophets hear.
That's right.
Okay, I believe our U.S. presidents moving forward, they need to have the kind of counsel that the kings of Israel, the kings of Judah had during Elisha's reign. Yes, I say Elisha's reign because he walked the earth as a heavenly king. So, Joshua 1:14. Let me read it to you again. Your wives, your little ones, and your cattle, as you take vision that I have. The next vision that I have, while this angel was standing next to me last night, this guardian angel, U.S. president, was I saw a man wearing a hat with a gray buffalo on it.
Okay. I didn't write the exact clip, but you all get the principle. That's what he showed you, that these people will need advisors and counselors, world leaders, presidents, heads of state. Things are going to come so bad that that's what they'll need to discern and make decisions. And y'all will send some people to those individuals, just like I told you, Daniel and the Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Babylon, and Joseph. All that stuff's going to be. So I'm moving on a little faster here because we've already set a pretty much premise of what we're showing here. Now, to jump around just a little bit here, let's see. Okay, let's do it this way. Now, there are also people all over the earth. Some of them are in Christian ministries. So we can't, as people who have come up under this vision of Dr. Kinley, whether in IDMR or otherwise, it does not mean that Yahweh doesn't have sheep of another fold. Mm-hmm. So we don't know where or how or when Yahweh will resurrect others that have the right heart and mind and spirit to want to know Yahweh, and they will be brought up under whatever guidance Yahweh gives them. And then, in other words, we can't just say that the end time assembly we will have will necessarily be all the individuals we think should be there. This is in the hands of Yahweh. He's a discerner of what thoughts and intents of the heart. So I'm going to move on to other people that have had prophetic dreams of economic failure. And this is a short video, very interesting. This is another Christian man, a gentleman named Shane Warren. He's on Sid Roth's show. It's Supernatural. He's on his show quite frequently. And this one is pretty short. It's only about 7 minutes. He's going to tell you about his vision he had in 2015. And it basically has to do with economic failure.
It's Supernatural.
Hello, Sid Roth here with Shane Warren. And Shane had a vision of the future of America. Shane, tell me, let's start out about the vision of the storm.
Approximately a year or so ago, I was sitting on the couch. I thought I had fallen asleep, when in reality, I was in a vision, an open vision. I have a large screen television in my living room. I was sitting on the couch watching television, and again, I thought I was dreaming. As I watched, there was a weather broadcast that was on television, and there was a news anchor who said, "The most amazing thing is going on right now. It's tragic, it's tragic." And they were building this news broadcast around this event. And he said, normally hurricanes hit on the coastal lines. He said, but there is a hurricane that seems to be spreading down or coming across the heartland of America. At that point, he showed a satellite image of America. And I was horrified as I watched a storm covering from the northern border to the southern border. From east to west is this massive storm with the eye right over the center of America, a hurricane coming across the center of America.
How can that be?
This is how I believe it happened. Immediately it came back to this anchor. The anchor said, "We have somebody on the ground in the eye of the storm. We're going to go to him now." They pitched it to a news reporter. This news reporter in the eye of the storm, and as you would see in a hurricane, the wind is blowing violently and they're being tossed to and fro. He said, "This is the most amazing thing. I don't understand it. This is not a natural storm." That was his words. He said, "This isn't normal." He said, "Look at what it's raining." And he reached down on the ground and he's picking up and he holds in his hand a fist of $1 bills. He said, This isn't natural. It's raining dollar bills." And the anchor and this correspondent went back and forth about the meaning of this dollar bills. He said, "I don't understand. It's almost like they're worthless. They're worthless. It was raining dollars." About that time, it came back to the anchor. He said, "Ladies and gentlemen, another tragedy has hit America." He said, "Right in the heartland of America, on the New Madrid Fault, a major earthquake has just hit." And immediately, pictures of devastation began to pop up all over America, the heartland of America, along the New Madrid Fault, as earthquakes caused entire cities to crumble. And while I was sitting there, I heard a booming voice in behind my ear that said, "They have divided my land, now I will divide their land."
And Leviticus says that Israel is God's land. He actually says, "This is..."
Now, you know, a lot of Christians, they still got that literal, physical Israel as a nation.
Yeah.
It's God's land. They've got that carnal, focused on the literal nation of Israel, on the literal soil of Israel. That's not what it's about. Israel is spiritual, not after the flesh.
Right.
mind by it. And the word of God goes on to prophesy in Joel, I believe it is, that if we divide his land, that God will divide our land. I never realized the prophetic implications of that, but I knew immediately in my dream or in this vision that he was speaking about Israel and specifically Jerusalem and all that's going on right now, which tells me that this dream that I've had and all of the issues that are going on with Israel and Jerusalem that's taking place right now, Sid, it tells me that this dream that I had is about to unfold because I heard that. And I saw the incredible changes in the prices of currency. Mm. I saw silver, not gold, but I saw silver begin to drastically increase in value. Not gold, but silver, which to me is against my natural thinking. I don't realize fully on it. I'm not an economist. I'm a preacher.
Well, I can tell you this. 20 years ago, I had a dream. I've only had a few dreams in my life in which God has come to me and spoken very, very, not symbolically, very clearly. And he told me the same thing. And that's one reason I'm really listening to what Shane is telling us.
I saw with that riots begin to break out. Major cities all over America broke out in riots. People were rioting in the streets. And on the sign is, give us our entitlements. Give us our entitlements. And it was literally war. I mean, it looked like civil war within our borders. But it was all...
I mean, really, pretty much have this situation now. People are... Right. We're struggling to hold on to your entitlements and the value of your entitlements and the amount of your entitlements. You know, if you're on pensions and what have you, I mean, you can see this is really already playing out now. Go ahead.
Over the issue of the devaluing of money. Mm-hmm. And then, Sid, immediately I was caught up and I was sitting in a room with world leaders. I can tell you that China was there. Iran was there. Russia was there. And here's what's amazing. Putin was there. Mm-hmm. And he just got reelected.
So this is going to be soon.
This, in my opinion, this is very soon.
Or it might be taking place now, what you're about ready to share.
I believe it's unfolding in the background. And I believe that the governments, world governments, including America, knows it's getting
ready. What was going on with this meeting?
In this meeting, these world leaders were talking about how to devalue the currency of America by buying oil on another currency, with another currency. And somehow or another, that would drive down the value of the American dollar. And when this happened, I realized this storm, as I'm sitting here watching this, I woke up and I realized I wasn't in a dream. I was still sitting up on the couch. I was looking at the television and I realized this was an open vision that God was showing me the storm that's about to come to America. And for you listeners that are watching right now, I'm telling you, you need to get ready and turn toward God. This we are on troubling days.
Okay. What is the hope that you also were shown by God?
Mm-hmm. Churches became cities of refuge. Mm-hmm.
And also the government wasn't helping people with need. Churches were
all of a sudden the body of Christ stood up like a mighty...
Don't think of that as churches, literally. Right? Mm-hmm. That would be all the sons of Yahweh from wherever.
Yeah.
Wherever they come out, if they have to be in physical churches, they have to be in this institute, they have to be, we don't know where. They will become converging together in what we talked about earlier. Cities of refuge to support each other. So you see, I just want to say these principles. The news in the news is showing you these things right before our eyes. In addition to the fact that they just happen to be fulfilling and repeating the purpose of Yahweh. So, I'll let him finish out there.
Sleeping giant in the earth and begin to, I feel the anointing on me right now as I'm talking to you, begin to minister, and people were coming to them, and I saw signs and wonders and miracles being poured out all over America. I saw America being shaken as the world couldn't go to the government anymore. They had to come back to the church for help.
Boy, what kind of glory did you see going on in the church? What kind of...
I saw literally like cities of refuge. Entire cities became cities of refuge where the scripture talks about there was rain in one city and no rain in another city. I saw that as people were plunging into these cities because there was life there. There was glory there. The presence of God was there. There was peace there. And they were running to that. and revival was taking place.
Okay, so you don't get the point. So that is how we will recover from the economic collapse in the land. So, as I said, this is the main thing y'all showed me about this is playing out right in front of our eyes, and even in our daily news. Y'all is giving us clues. This is where you are. I'm repeating these principles and events with certain with individuals all over the world, and including people having visions. So, there's a lot in here I won't get to. It's a fairly long outline. Just a couple things I'll kind of highlight, and then we'll see if there's any other things I really wanted to draw out today. Another famous evangelistic minister named Neville Johnson, he's kind of diddling what this man Shane Warren saw. He's saying that the miracles and the signs that will be performed by the true sons of Yahweh at the end of this age, he says they will be off the chain. But I mean off the chain, I'm paraphrasing what's in the video, I won't have time to play it. But he said people like with Down syndrome, by the power of the Holy Spirit, will be cured, completely cured as if they never had it. Mm-hmm. Now the Messiah in his ministry, what? Woman touches him with garment, him with his garment, power went out from him, and what? Wasn't like weeks later, one day later, she was instantaneously healed. And he said the true sons will manifest these powers even greater than those that Yahshua gave to the apostles when he gave them power. You go out and cast out spirits, etc. I'm just highlighting this. So let's read the scripture here, John 14 and 12.
Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I shall do, he do also. Mm-hmm. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto the Father.
Okay, so skipping around, this is pretty long. Things like, he says, God is going to take these signs and wonders to a whole new level. Unheard of. He said, for example, people could lose limbs and the limbs would be fully restored. This stuff is just going to be off the chain. Even if it's not little, these manifestations you can see, there has to be a greater power infused upon the sons because we have what? Greater hardship, greater chaos, greater manifestation of how the system is going to collapse that we have to, sojourn through. Now, what I will play from this that I thought was quite interesting, this is, again, Neville Johnson. He's a Christian evangelist and minister. What I will play very briefly is he said that he talks about many world leaders, kings and queens all over the world. He says that they are being visited and warned by God. And I'll play that quick clip, and then we'll, one more thing, and then we'll ask, end up with any questions or comments here.
You don't have many years to live anywhere now on the earth, so blood moon coming, you see. These get hands. That's okay. You don't have many years to live anywhere now on the earth, so it's okay. It's a weapon. How would you like God to choose you as a weapon to take a city? Oh, hallelujah. Therefore, the goodness, behold the goodness and the severity of God. Romans 11:22, behold, therefore, goodness, the severity of God. It's going to be released this year, starting this year, the goodness and the severity of God. Let me tell you something. Leaders of this world are now being, many of the leaders of this world are being visited by God or some of his saints.
Okay, that's the point.
To give them time to repent. All of them. Leaders of the world. I know this for a fact. And kings, queens, people high up like the Rockefellers and the financial one, given time to repent. But the cutoff point is the Day of Atonement this year. There's no more time to repent for these people. It ends the Day of Atonement. This blood moon coming, you see, this year ends something. The world is going to change. Oprah is being visited by a saint to tell her to repent. He's a Luciferian. She's what you call on the outside a white witch, but on the inside a very dark witch. She has tremendous power over people and their minds. But she's being visited. God's visiting people all around the world. Now if God is doing that, something is going down.
That's right.
Really is. And there's a cutoff point coming just months away.
So what would that be? What that principle be a repeat of? Well, Nebuchadnezzar and all his power and his exaltation, Yahweh visited him and brought him down. He was made almost like unto a madman, or he turned almost beast-like. And then he had to what? Acknowledge repent and acknowledge that Yahweh was a true Elohim before he got released from that. So, like I said, I'm thankful to Yahweh. Just allowed me to share some of these principles that he showed me. We should be looking at these events, looking at these signs. And there is news that is in the news that is showing us where we are in the purpose of Yahweh. We just have to apply what our pattern and our purpose that we're taught in the school to clearly see these things. Now, the last segment I was going to cover, but I don't really think I need to because we really covered it in principle. We didn't just get a chance to read the article. But Mother Earth is about to do some serious shaking and quaking. And that's, I was talking about the earthquakes, literally. And why are these things happening so frequently? Why would we have an increase of so many earthquakes and tremors in California? And recently they had a magnitude of 4.3 earthquake in California. That's a 430. Just add the zero. 43, that's a 430. That puts us right down here as a sign coming out of what? 430. After 430 years, what? It came up out of Egypt. Then they had a piece in an article out about this magma, which is basically a form of magma or lava underneath California. Let's see, we might have time to take a quick look at that. All kinds of physical earth changes are occurring very rapidly. Tectonic plates were moving. There's an earthquake in Portugal, and they basically said that it was because of a tectonic plate peeling apart. I mean, these signs are something else. It's just truly something else. I'm just paraphrasing a couple of these last articles because we won't have time. Volcanoes are waking up all around the world. There's much more activity along the Ring of Fire of volcanoes erupting. Some of this stuff is just not in our regular traditional news. They're just not covering this stuff. You have to go to some of these alternative sites. There's approximately some 450 active and dormant volcanoes along the Ring of Fire. So volcanoes are waking up, pardon me. Earthquakes are on the increase. And all of these things, all these signs in the earth and signs in the heaven and heavens. And Stan Dale talked about signs of the physical sign. There's signs that Yellowstone is about to blow over. You know, it's about to erupt. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. This is the article Penny sent out. I have a minute to bring this one up. It says 240 cubic miles of magma was just discovered beneath California's supervolcano. I didn't even know that California had a lot of volcanoes, not just fault lines. California is generally known for the earthquake fault lines. It also has about 8 active volcanoes that are being monitored.
Wow.
In California. I said in California? Read that again.
They do have a lot of mountains.
Well, yes. So I guess you would say, you would think, but yeah. Again, if you don't know about it, you don't know. And if it's not being reported, this is the one I think that Penny sent out. That's all right. I can copy the link. And then I'm going to continue on that. It's from the fourth website, but that's not the one. Let me try something else. I also have a link in my old version of my outline. But you know, one ledger can't possibly cover all this. Just here, let's try it here. Sent this out to our mainly our class members in Chicago. 240 cubic miles of magma was just discovered beneath California's supervolcano, and this is recent. This is from August 16th. I'm sorry, last year. I'm sorry, August 16th of 2018. Sorry, last year. Anyway, so this is called, referred to as the Long Valley Supervolcano in California. As it says here, one of the largest supervolcanoes in the world sits underneath California, lying dormant for the past 100,000 years. Now researchers have gotten a clearer glimpse into what lies beneath the Long Valley supervolcano, uncovering 240 cubic miles of magma sitting beneath California. So that was quite shocking to me as well. So in this lecture today, I just wanted us to begin to look at many signs and many witnesses. Down here at the end of the age, Yahweh is showing us things we need to start thinking about and preparing for, that this system as we know it is going to collapse. It's going to have financial collapse. It's going to have all manner of chaos, destruction, blackouts. All those principles will repeat. And including the fact that everything will be shaken. All the institutions that we've relied on, you know, will be shaken. And that this is a time we have to go to the Spirit within us and rely on Yahweh to deliver us. And these are just signs for us to get ready, warning signs to the sons. So in conclusion, in this lecture has been shown that Yahweh is generously, very generously, pouring out warnings, visions, dreams, and visitations as witnesses to his sons and daughters. A sweeping changes of all kinds that will occur at the end of this age. Also, many signs are being given via various events occurring in the earth plane, even in the current events we see in the news. We should count it for blessings that he is not only using vessels to sound the warning, but also to prepare us both physically and psychologically, and of course spiritually, for the events to come. Now more than ever, we are in need of this spiritual intervention in our lives, as we approach unprecedented chaos, distress, wars, rumors of wars, and the total exposure of the mystery Babylon witnesses. As we are about to face this unprecedented chaos, great changes in America, drastic economic collapse, and these earth changes, Yahweh is giving his sons and daughters warnings so we can prepare and trust that he will, what he is able to deliver us. He was also showing us how he will provide us protection and refuge, for surely we will need it. And with that, I'll close and open for any questions. Yes. Yeah, I didn't say if that's what it is. So a lot of these could have been ancient volcanoes, you know, in California, but all over the world. There's a ring of fire where it's a lot of volcanic activity. That's in an area of the Pacific Ocean, all the way from Asia to California to the northwestern coast of America, Oregon, Washington State. All those, all that geography lies in the ring of fire. And there's about 450 volcanoes in that ring of fire. Not all of them are active. Some of them are dormant. So we don't know how. Yahweh can make whatever that was formerly dormant. And that does include some of those volcanoes are under the ocean. They're not all above the sea level. Some of them are under the ocean. So anything anybody wants to add or comments? Or? If not, I'll yield and give Little Wings a chance.
Thank you.